You are trying to look at how to lift the performance of the most able students. And with its vibrant and highly diverse school system, Australia does generally well on that. But it's perhaps the area where Australia's school system has recently been most challenged. I know you're all well aware of the decline of student performance in Australia on our international PISA assessments, even if that decline comes from a high level. But it's noteworthy that this decline has been mainly driven by students losing out at the high end of the performance distribution. For example, between 2003 and 2012, Australia's share of top performing students in mathematics has dropped from over 20% to just 15%. That's still slightly above the average in the industrialized world, but it's just around half of what we have seen in many of your East Asian neighbors in terms of educational excellence. And interestingly, this isn't largely or even mainly a story of socioeconomic disadvantage, about underperformance of poor kids from poor neighborhoods. No, it is a story about many kids from many neighborhoods and from many schools in Australia. Look at it this way. The 10% of the most disadvantaged 15-year-olds in Shanghai in China still outperform 70% of the Australian student population. Why does it all matter? It matters because job growth in the industrialized world is now mainly driven by the high end of the skill distribution. But we need to look ahead of what excellence in education really means. In fact, labor demand in the industrialized world shows amazing changes over the last decades. The steepest decline in skill demand is no longer in the area of manual skills, but in routine cognitive skills. Memorizing something and expecting that's going to help us later in our life. Put simply, the world no longer rewards people just for what they know. Google knows everything. But for what they can do with what they know. That is the key differentiator today. And by the way, one of the traditional strengths of Australian schools. When we can access the world's knowledge on the internet, when routine skills are being digitized or outsourced, and when jobs are changing rapidly, then accumulating knowledge matters less and success becomes increasingly about ways of thinking. That's about creativity, critical thinking, problem solving, judgment, about ways of working, including collaboration and teamwork, and about the social cultural tools that enable us to interact with the world. In a nutshell, schools need to prepare students for jobs that have not yet been created, to use technologies that have not yet been invented, and to solve problems we just can't imagine today. We can no longer ignore countries like China. Today, the talent pool is roughly equal in Europe, the United States, and China. But in 2025, a decade from now, China alone will have more highly educated kids than Europe and the United States have kids. It's worth getting this right. If the industrialized world would raise its learning outcomes by 25 PISA points, and that's the level of improvement that we have seen in a country like Brazil or Poland over the last decade, then our economies could be richer by over 120 trillion Australian dollars over the lifetime of today's students. Conventionally, our approach to problems in schools was breaking them down into manageable bits and pieces and then to teach students the techniques to solve those pieces. But today, we create value by synthesizing the different bits, by integrating different fields of knowledge. That's about curiosity, open-mindedness, making connections between ideas that seem unrelated, and which requires being familiar with and receptive to knowledge in other fields than our own. If we spend our whole life in a silo of a single discipline, we will simply not gain the imaginative skills to connect the dots where the next innovation is going to come from. The world is also no longer divided between specialists who know a lot about very little and generalists who know little about a lot. What matters today is our capacity to keep learning and growing, to build new relationships, to assume new roles, and to reposition ourselves every day new in this fast-changing world. Last but not least, Much of the time in school is spent learning individually. But the more interdependent the world becomes, the greater the premium on great collaborators and orchestrators. Innovation today is rarely the product of individuals working in isolation, but an outcome of how we mobilize, share, and link knowledge. Everything that's our proprietary knowledge today is going to be a commodity available to everyone else tomorrow. Expressed differently, we're seeing a shift from a world of stocks, which knowledge that is stacked up somewhere depreciating rapidly in value, to a world in which the enriching power of collaboration and communication is rising. The key question, of course, is how schools can develop that knowledge and skills. And that too is an area where the best performing education systems can tell us a lot. In traditional bureaucratic school systems, teachers were often left alone in classrooms with a lot of prescription of what to teach. Top-performing school systems set ambitious goals, are clear about what students should be able to do, and they then provide teachers with the tools to establish what content and instruction they need to deliver to their individual students. The past was about delivered wisdom. The future is about user-generated wisdom. Often, different students are taught in similar ways. Well, top performers embrace diversity with differentiated pedagogical practices. And that's not just about countering educational disadvantage, but also about creating opportunities that capitalize on the most talented students. The goal of the past was standardization and conformity. Now it's about being ingenious, about personalizing educational experiences. The past was curriculum-centered. The future is learner-centered. Traditionally, the policy focus was on the provision of education, and top performers its own outcomes, shifting from looking upwards in the bureaucracy towards looking outwards to the next teacher, to the next school. Traditionally, we emphasized school management, but top performers are strong on leadership, with a focus on supporting, evaluating, and developing teacher quality as its core. And that includes coordinating the curriculum and teaching program, monitoring and evaluating teacher practice, promoting teacher professional development, and supporting collaborative work cultures. We also need to take to heart that learning is not a place, but an activity. School systems need to better recognize that individuals learn differently, and differently at different stages of their lives. They need to foster new forms of educational provision that take learning to the learner in ways that allow people to learn in the ways that are most conducive to their own progress. And that's also about creating more innovative partnerships. Isolation in a world of complex learning systems will seriously limit potential. Powerful learning environments are constantly creating synergies and finding new ways to enhance professional, social and cultural capital with others. And they do that with families and with communities, with higher education, with businesses, and especially with other schools and learning environments.